Alles gut.
Perfect. My name is Nadica Miljković. I'm associate professor at the University of Belgrade, and today I'm going to present you a presentation titled Passengers' Experience in Automated Vehicles, with special focus on overview of electrogastrography application for car sickness assessment. The research presented within the presentation is done by joint collaboration between University of Ljubljana, so Professor Jaka Sodnik is also present here, and between University of Belgrade, and Dr. Popovic from University of Belgrade is also present here for possible further discussion after the presentation. So the topics that I'd like to cover today include introduction to motion sickness, but you've already heard something on that from Professor Boston's previous lecture. I'd like to say something about automated vehicles and simulated automated vehicles and passenger sickness, and then to elaborate on EGG or electrogastrography method for sickness assessment, and to finish this presentation with some challenges and opportunities for this physiological measure. The presentation also includes the results of PhD thesis. As you can see, I put a disclaimer with the dimmed letters here. And for more information on other biosignals and our work on it, there is another publicly available presentation. Okay. Basic Q&A of motion sickness include many hows, whens, whats, and so on. So symptoms that a person can feel are dizziness, sweating, but the most common symptom is nausea leading to vomiting, as you heard before. Despite feeling it during the travels, space, sea, air, car, train travel, people can experience it during the consumption of virtual reality, but also during riding animals like camels and elephants, during sport activities like skiing. There are numerous ways to suppress motion sickness and these symptoms, and I've selected some published ways. So chewing ginger, if you didn't know, can also suppress sickness symptoms. Deep breathing, biofeedback has proven its efficacy. There are also devices such as relief band, which is, for example, used on the wrist to stimulate median nerve and to deliver electrical stimulation to the subject. It was also clinically tested after general anesthesia in patients who underwent operational procedure. When talking about proneness to sickness, basically there are two major groups of people who went to be prone. There are some genetic factors and environmental factors. So you heard about that in previous presentations, but for example, in most of the studies, but not in all studies, females had larger sickness symptoms than males, for example, and people having flu, ear infection can also experience larger intensity of sickness. Why do we feel it? Is not known yet. Three theories emerged, and the most widely accepted theory is the sensory conflict theory. But there is also evolutionary theory, and as an evolutionary theory, it's hard to prove, but it's the most interesting. It says that our body sensory mismatch actually thinks about sensory mismatch as a poisoning. That's actually the signal that our body experiences, and we tend to feel nausea and vomit in order to feel better and to throw out our poison. If you consider the known fairy tale about Snow White, then there is a tiny little detail that we have to add, is that her awakening after eating poisonous apple was together with vomiting, which brings new light and colors to this very known tale. But I should get back to our topic, it's automated vehicles and sickness assessment. As you're familiar, automation of driving function makes our drivers more becoming passengers, and then engaging them in non-driving activities, especially in levels 4 and 5 of these levels of driving automation. So one of the benefits is engagement in other activities, and one of the costs is actually motion or car sickness, among other costs. Sickness is poorly understood, and for in-depth analysis, we propose and proposed recording of electrical potentials originating from the smooth stomach muscles. To relax a little bit this line of terms, I wanted to introduce you to electrical potentials in humans. So, for example, you must be all familiar with the electrical heart activity, electrocardiogram, ECG, and you can hear here heartbeats. Then there is also electrical activity of the brain, electroencephalograph. There is also electrical activity of the skeletal muscles or electromyogram, EMG. And in the end, these are just selected measures, just to give that disclaimer about the slide. We propose this measure, EGG, which actually show us the electrical activity of the stomach smooth muscles. In case you didn't know, EGG is not a novel method. It was introduced 100 years ago by Walter Alvarez in the United States. And in his publication, Alvarez stated that after a couple of years of solving technical challenges, he managed to record electrical activity of the smooth stomach muscles. During 50s and 60s, we had rediscovery of electrical potentials in the muscle by application of invasive technologies, but I'm not here going to talk about invasive but non-invasive surface technology that was popularized again during 80s and 90s in the last century. Why? Because hardware was developed on a level that we could measure the signals with lower noise and with high quality electronics and amplifiers. There are a variety of directions where EGG related research is now going on. One of them is high resolution gut mapping by application of many recording channels. But despite also clinical applications, there is one thing that we should have in mind with this method. It's not yet adopted in clinics, and it's unfortunately not standardized. But in case that you want to perform EGG-based assessment procedure, the things you must do, have to do actually, is to use this surface silver chloride electrodes, very the same as used for ECG or electrical heart activity. And here you can see 5 of them. One is here a ground electrode, then we have a reference electrode, and here is for 3 channels setup recording. They're placed over on the skin or over the area that covers stomach. In comparison to quantitative, it gives quantitative assessment, and in comparison to qualitative questionnaires like motion sickness questionnaire, simulator sickness app questionnaire, and even to fast motion sickness questionnaire. This method can be used quasi real time. I have a reason why I say quasi real time, but actually can perform many measures and many assessments during the time. And it's not obtrusive in the sense of subjects' cognition. They don't have to answer questions. The electrodes are placed on their stomach. So what can you expect of EGG records? The signal is known to recognize 3 rhythms. First is normal rhythm, it's called normogastrium, and it includes 2 to 4 cycles per minute. This is really slow signal, and you have to be really patient to record it. And that's why I say quasi real time, because for some analysis, you need to have a buffer and you need to wait for some time to gather all the samples to analyze them afterwards. And there are 2 dysrhythmias. First one is fast rhythm. It's up to 10 cycles per minute. And the second one is slow stomach rhythm. It's down to 1 cycle per minute. And here you can see how these rhythms look like. So it's normal, then bradygastria slow and tachygastria fast rhythm. You can probably notice the very low amplitude of these signals in microvolts. And also this range of bradygastria, due to its really low frequency content, it can be really vulnerable to artifacts and noises as well as whole EGG signal. In case you wonder, we don't have this rhythmical activity, normal rhythmical activity all the time. Normal people without any pathologies have 70% of time this normal rhythm. Of course, this measure can be used for diagnosis, because if some person has less than 70%, then it means that there is some kind of a pathology and something is going on with the stomach. Also, interesting studies include measurements in newborns. So at the first week of life, babies have up to 40% of normal rhythm present during the day. And by the 6 months, they have 65, so close to 70% of normal rhythm. Variety of things can be assessed with these signals. So EGG has been used since 80s for motion sickness assessment, because it can monitor stomach dysrhythmias. Dysrhythmias are important because they present one of the important features that is going to emerge when there is nausea sensation in a subject. So if you place EGG electrodes and record EGG signal in a subject that is experiencing nausea, then we should see dysrhythmias in EGG. In most cases, it will be faster rhythm of the stomach. And in most cases, the amplitude and total power of the signal will be increased. Of course, the main bottleneck for EGG wider adoption, for motion sickness, and for its standardization, it's susceptible to artifacts, even 100 years ago after its first introductions. Because of some contradictory findings, that most of them probably originated from individual differences when motion sickness was studied, limitations and some precautions, limitations should be had in mind, and some precautions are advised when someone uses EGG. So, first time when we wanted to assess sickness with EGG, we applied something that probably gets to your mind too, is to use Oculus Rift and to use roller coaster virtual reality and to see what is going to happen with EGG in our subject. And I'm going to show it right away, our results. So here, you can see a normal rhythm in a subject during resting. And please do see that this is zero, from minus 0.2 to 0.2 millivolts. And that when there is VR, this is the second 4 minutes long window, you can see an increase in amplitude. So I put the scales here, which are 10 times larger. In literature, it was reported that after 1 to 3 minutes after exposing a subject to optokinetic drum, there is a change in gastric dysrhythmia. And this is something similar that happened in our subject too, after like 2.5 minutes, there was change in the gastric rhythm. And also literature on motion sickness and optokinetic, induced by optokinetic drum, said that after 3 minutes of the beginning of gastric dysrhythmia, the subject should report nausea, and it was similar in our case. Interesting finding is this VR doesn't last long. It's like about 4 minutes long VR, and you can see after the virtual reality is finished, you can see changes in the gastric rhythm. There is a recovery, of course, but it takes time to recover stomach rhythm after virtual reality exposure. So I guess now you can get impression what can we measure and what can we assess. And here I've put a power spectral density for these corresponding parts of the signal. So you can see something that is known for the normal rhythm is that its spectrum has one dominant frequency, which is, if you see the scale, in range of normal rhythm. But when we are exposure takes place, and when this rhythm appears, you can see the shifts of the frequency, but despite the shift of this dominant frequency, you can also see the change in the spectral shape. So no one previously focused on the change of the spectral shape, and that was, I think, one of the main novelties in the signal analysis that we introduced. And afterwards, of course, in this PSD power spectral density windows, you can see recovery process. This is not yet fully recovered subject, of course. So in our studies with driving simulators and automated driving simulation, we calculated EGG parameters in both frequency and time domain for the sake of completeness. I've put all the parameters that we used here, but I'm going to focus later in the next two slides only on two most important parameters that we use for assessing shape of power spectral density. What we found is that some parameters, especially those in time domain, are important and that they can be, in most cases, used for short-term assessment, which is good, but we also had some long-term parameters. When I say long-term, I think that you have to have a finished part of the scenario, finished then to calculate parameters for the whole scenario. And in that case, you can't have real-time assessment or quasi-real-time. In the second case, you can. So our general advices for measuring and analysis of EGG are summed in these references, but I also took some most outstanding advices. The first one is that we have to really be careful about noises and subject movements especially. So we have to devote our time for artifact and noise elimination. Baseline and reference recording is a must for the most physiological measures and as well as for EGG. We also combined standard assessment procedures like questionnaires, and we found that long-term and short-term features can be both usable, and also in order to compare, you remember those times when gastric dysrhythmia appears and when subject feels nauseated, we introduced nausea button. So instead of answering the question, our subject would give signal by pressing the button that he or she feels nauseated. Of course, they could stop at any time, and they were introduced to that procedure. And also, there was an interesting part of the nausea button because they could press it more time to prove to show the intensity of their symptoms, which is of course subjective, but we were eager to see some differences. Before presenting the results of our study, I wanted to show you how we assessed power spectral density shape. In this case, it's just the magnitude of the Fourier transform. So you can see here the dominant frequency of the spectrum, which is usually normal finding when a person has normal rhythm during baseline recording. So we calculated the dominant peak and compared that for and divided it with the root mean square value of the power spectral density, in this case, with fast Fourier transform, and we got the crest factor of the PSD. Crest factor helped us assess the peak prominence part of the power spectral density. And there is also one interesting parameter that we introduced. It's called median frequency, and actually we borrowed it from studying electrical potentials of skeletal muscles, electromyography field, and median frequency is the frequency that shares power spectral density into two parts that have equal surface area on the curve is equal. So in cases when you have not just dominant frequency shift, but when you have all power spectrum density shift towards larger frequencies, towards faster rhythm, median frequency is the parameter that helps us assess in assessment of that change. So the scenario was that we applied Oculus Rift, and this is a recording from the Nervtex driving simulator, where we also subject was on a curvy and dynamic country road in this case, and these are some inserts from the recording. So here you can see normal rhythm, also here in zoomed, and dominant frequency, which was expected. And later on, I don't know how this grave turns out, but here you can see insert how it looks like when subject is driving actually in simulated automated vehicle, and you can see definite changes in power spectral density here. Also, you might here see the changes of detected amplitude increase of dysrhythmia onset and how a subject pressed the button after around 2 minutes after the gastric dysrhythm change. So when we calculated parameters for EGG, this is the table inset from the publication. You can see that all parameters, we had expected trends, We obtained all expected trends, but not all parameters proved statistically significant. For example, for the last two parameters that I showed, crest factor, assessing the peak prominence, has proven to be statistically significant. And it was increased in subjects during automated driving simulation. I haven't mentioned before, but I think that Professor Boss gave a perfect introduction in combining physiological measures. We did also measure galvanic skin response or electrodermal activity and heart rate, but I'm not going into details in these parameters. One thing that I should note here, and it's not given in the table, in this particular study, we found significant correlation between root mean square of the amplitude of EGG in time domain with the result of the questionnaire, which was really a nice expected finding. So to sum up my presentation with some practical considerations, there are basically opportunities in using this technique for quantitative short-term and long-term assessment. It provides also prosperous combination with other signals, but there are also challenges that we need to solve, especially vulnerability to body movements. And there is something really interesting, but I don't have enough time to elaborate on that. Emotions might be also one of the influencing factors of our stomach rhythm, and I think that they both present opportunity and challenge at the same time. Okay. I believe that EGG-based features may not correlate with qualitative assessment because we found statistically significant correlation only in one of our studies and only in one parameter. So, this is the slide I was talking about at the beginning of the day. Simulated reality is not a reality. So despite that driving simulators provide fantastic testing framework and attractive testing framework, the sicknesses produced by the simulator, car sickness and automated driving sickness, may not be the same. But some studies performed before suggest that symptoms are similar, but the causes are different. severity of symptoms is higher in driving simulation. And this is also proved by comparison of motion sickness and cyber sickness, that symptoms are higher in cases of cyber sickness. There are no study with EGG, but if you're interested, there are some findings that might be used to get some insight into the differences between simulated reality and reality assessed by EGG. So for future directions, there are some directions in a far, far away future, like less obtrusive procedures with EGG. Personally, I don't think we are going to see non-contact measurement of EGG any soon enough. Maybe not even in my lifetime, but we see every day advanced processing methods for noise elimination being published, and that promises a lot. Also, EGG may provide a framework for effective design strategies, for example, for automated vehicles. And as you saw, gastric dysrhythmias precede the nausea feeling, so we might be able to predict motion sickness. And also there is one interesting thing that I'm not aware of, neither my co-authors, that it's been studied before with EGG and car sickness. But 20 years ago, there was a study funded by NASA in the space station Mir, where they measured EGG in astronauts, and they concluded that after 3 days of being present at a space station, gastric rhythms comes to a normal rhythm. And the first day, of course, as you can expect, there are astronauts suffer tremendously. They experience nausea and vomiting, and they have increased dysrhythmical activity. So application of other sensing principles is also interesting when this method is vulnerable to artifacts, but it can also provide a fantastic framework to measure at the same time gastric cycle, respiratory cycle, and heartbeat. So this is the first time I've ever seen working turn your weaknesses into strength. And I'd be happy to share this presentation under a Creative Commons license afterwards this session. And I'd also like to call my co-authors to join me in the following discussion if we have some time.
Thanks for this very nice presentation. And yes, we have time because we have the lunch break.